Are you seeking fulfillment for your life? Do you want freedom from fear? That's why we're here. Welcome to Jesus 101, introducing you to the real Jesus. And now, here's your host, Elizabeth Talbot.
Welcome to Jesus 101. I'm so glad you decided to join us once again. We continue with our series on the life of David, a study in brokenness, actually, because there was a long time between his anointing and his appointing. And now we are in the second book of Samuel, where he actually will be not only appointed king, but the rest of the story of the life of David will go on. So we have transitioned from 1 Samuel to 2 Samuel, and today's program is where God will make a covenant with David, and he will tell him some things about his own future that David didn't know, like, for example, that he was going to ratify his kingdom. After him, there would be a descendant that would come and would continue the kingdom. And I think there's nothing like this for a parent to know that one of his children is continuing the legacy. And long time ago, I showed you this picture that I'm going to show you today, but I'm going to show it to you again because it has a lot of meaning to me, and now even more because my dad is no longer with us. And this is my commissioning certificate. You know, our church, after several years that you are in, a pastor, they commission you. They ratify your calling, per se, publicly. And all these people come and are administrators of the church, and they say, well, this person from now on is a minister of the church. And obviously the government also accepts that, so you can marry and bury and etc. So my father did the homily for my commissioning service, and his signature is right here. Is the most important signature for me, even though different administrative roles were represented and signed this commissioning certificate. But his signature is there. And in his homily, he said a lot of things that I will never forget. One of them was, I feel I'm passing the torch. Now, my daughter will continue in the ministry. My dad, since he was a very young man, I think it was about 21 or 22 when he joined the church in a ministerial capacity, and he did all the way to his retirement. So he had 40 plus years of service. And I remember that one sentence, you know, I feel I'm passing the torch today. And it made me feel very warm, and at the same time, a sense of responsibility to continue with the ministry. And obviously, is a call from God that I have, is not from men. But still, the fact that my dad was there doing the homily, saying this. And 2 weeks ago, I did his memorial service in the same church, by the same platform that he took that time. And I actually made a mention of this because a lot of things that are very meaningful to me happen in that same church. And he talked about being a good shepherd, that Jesus is our model, but that as pastors, we're also shepherds. And this time it was my time to do his memorial service. And so I talked about Psalm 23. But there's something about this event when you, as a parent, feel that you are passing the torch. And in this covenantal chapter that we're going to see today, David is given the great news that he will have descendants that will continue the kingdom, and that God has decided to establish him. It's not because David is so good that it will continue. It's because God has chosen David and appointed him king and his descendants. Thank you so much, Pastor Mike Tucker, for being with us today.
Well, thank you for having me. Happy to be here.
We're so glad that you joined us for the whole series. Thank you so much.
Absolutely.
Maybe you want to tell people what you do.
Oh, I'm the speaker director for Faith for Today Television, the oldest religious television broadcast in the world. And our flagship program is called Lifestyle Magazine, and I'm the host of that program. We added to it a little something called Mad About Marriage. And that is a television broadcast, so as well as live events and seminars and then small group curriculum to follow up. So that's what I actually do for a living. You don't pay me to be here. I've noticed that. I kept checking my bank account and nothing has shown up yet. And so obviously
this is not the way you make a living.
No, this is not the way I make a living.
Yeah, but this is the way you make a life because you love to talk about the Bible and
always,
Jesus. And
always.
So that's why we keep inviting him.
All right.
We always put his website under his name so that you can, this mm-hmm. is a joint effort between two ministries, Jesus 101 and Faith for Today. Mm-hmm. And we are always very, very happy to be able to collaborate together.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. I think two are better than one. Mm-hmm. So thanks for being here.
Sure.
So today we are in this moment in which God will remind David who he is mm-hmm. and will remind David and say, look, let me tell you where I brought you from. Mm-hmm. And what I'm making out of it, and what's going to happen when you're no longer here. Mm-hmm. I mean, I heard, tell me if this is true, that you have a daughter that just became a pastor.
Yes, yes. She was in education for a while, uh-huh. and now she has gone to the same church that her mother and I used to pastor for 17 years.
Wow.
To be a pastor of children's ministry and women and seniors. And she's just accepted that role here the last 6 months or so ago. And her mother knew that before she passed away.
That
That she had accepted the position, actually.
Oh, wow.
It had not been made public yet, but her mother knew that she had accepted and would be going there.
Now,
so
being
really
that
happy.
My dad is no longer here and I cannot ask him what it feels like, I'm
yeah.
going to ask you, what does it feel like to have your daughter continue in your steps?
There's a tremendous amount of pride that goes with that, joy. To know that your children are following in the path that you have led, mm-hmm. that they did not reject it, mm-hmm. but instead that they have embraced it and seen it as their own calling as well.
Mm-hmm.
That's gratifying to know that. And also, I know what her theology is. I know
of
that
course.
It's the same
she's
as mine.
She's grace-oriented.
Yes.
And Jesus-oriented.
So, and she's a scholar. She's a student. And I know that this will continue on in her preaching and her ministry as
Isn't
well.
Isn't that amazing?
So the Lord has a way of allowing you to see those things, and that's
very
gratifying.
Giving you a full
gratifying.
Circle, per se.
Yeah,
right?
And her mother saw that too before she died and knew that was an exciting part
and
for her.
And that always fulfilled
yes.
her. Yeah.
Yes.
Wow. So you're knowing a little bit of what David might have felt.
Oh, sure.
So today we are going to one of the most important chapters in the Bible because we have this ongoing promise of God, mm-hmm. assurance of God, that he will deliver his people. You know, Genesis 3, we all left God and God said, look, I'm going to provide a savior, right?
Genesis 3:15, he talks about what the future would be, that Satan would crush his heel, but that he would crush Satan's
head. Right?
That's right.
So that's the beginning of what we call the covenant. And we have several pillars that are, the covenant is repeated. We have, mm-hmm. the main ones are Adam, mm-hmm. Noah, Abraham, Moses, David, and Jesus. Those are
right.
the six main pillars of the covenant. Of course, it will be repeated to other people like Jacob, and
sure,
et cetera,
sure.
et cetera. But David is one of the six main ones.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the chapter when God reveals kind of the future to him.
It's important to know that a covenant is different than a contract. A contract is usually between two equals. If I agree to buy your car, we agree on the money. I give you the money, you give me the car. It's an equal exchange.
Mm-hmm.
But in a covenant, is usually made between a greater being and a lesser being. The lesser being simply remains in relationship and the greater being does all the work.
Mm-hmm.
Earlier in chapter 5, verse 3, we saw David made a covenant with his subjects.
Mm-hmm.
So he said, as long as you remain my subjects, this is what
this
I
what
do,
I'm gonna
for
do
you.
For
this
you.
Is what I do for you. And now God has said, because you are my subject, David,
yes.
and all of the earth is my subject, this is
what
I will do for you.
And it's very important because a lot of people are going, okay, I have to do this and that, and I don't know how I'm going to do this
you
and that.
You remain in relationship.
Yeah.
You just say, all right, I'm your child.
Yeah.
I mess up,
so,
but
so
I'm
do
yours.
Whatever.
I accept your covenant.
Yeah,
I
love that. And one of the first things we did together was in the Pasadena City College.
Mm-hmm.
We did a live television program.
Yeah, remember.
And I remember you talked about that, and mm-hmm. I was like, wow, that is great. That was a long time ago when you mm-hmm. were young. I don't know if you
I can't remember that far back,
yeah,
actually.
Yeah, there you go. Okay, so we're in 2 Samuel chapter 7.
Mm-hmm.
And the first thing God is going to do is remind David where he has come from.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're going to read 2 Samuel chapter 7, verses 8, 9, and 10.
It says, "Now therefore, thus you shall say to my servant David, thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture and from following the sheep to be ruler over my people Israel. I have been with you wherever you have been, you have gone, and have cut off all your enemies from before you. And I will make you a great name, like the names of the great men who are on the earth. I will also appoint a place for my people Israel, and will plant them, that they may live in their own place and not be disturbed again, nor will the wicked afflict them any more as formerly."
Okay, so the first thing that I did when I was studying this, I started circling all the I's.
Yeah. Yeah, what he would do.
Yeah. First of all, I love the fact that he went back to the past. I have one of those sandals that people make in bronze to remember their children. Mm-hmm. Have you seen these?
Oh, I don't know.
Did you make these for your children?
Not for my children, but I think one was made for me. Yeah, when
I was
little. That was more popular. I think my mother has it. I'm not sure.
Okay.
I don't wear it anymore.
So that is it was from the year 1845?
Yeah, about right.
1845, right. That's when Michael was born. No, but this is actually somebody's sandal, right?
Mm-hmm.
We do this to remember our child was like this. This
was
is precious,
small.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
David, God does something like this with David. Says, look, when you were a boy and you were tending the sheep, I already saw you there.
Yeah. That's when I chose you.
Yeah, I chose you already from your mother's womb, really.
Mm-hmm.
And so you didn't get to be king because you were something great. No, you were this little boy with a harp and sheep.
Mm-hmm.
And I took you from there. And look where you are now. You are now the king of Israel. You're going to shepherd my people. But I did that. Look at all the eyes.
Yeah. And what does it say that David did?
Nothing.
Exactly.
Nothing, honey. See, I love that because when you're chosen by something, and the other day somebody called and said, I've been asked to be an elder in my church, but I don't feel that I have what it takes. And the truth is,
no one does.
You never have what it takes.
No.
Right? It's a covenant that God has made with you that if you want to be in relationship with me, this is what I will do.
Yeah.
And this is how I will use you for my purposes.
Again, God has never called a qualified person, but he's never failed to qualify anyone who he has called.
And he does it.
He does the qualifying. He does the calling. He does the qualifying, not you.
Yes.
It's
and
not
I think
about
it's
you.
So important. Look at this. Verse 8, it says, I took you from the pasture, David.
Yeah.
You didn't come up one day and say, I'm going to be king.
Yeah.
I took you from the pasture, says God. I have been with you wherever you have gone, and I have cut off your enemies from before you.
That's right.
Look what I've done in the past. I chose you, I've been with you, and I even protected you. You know, someday I'll talk to my guardian angel.
Yeah. Those stories will be many.
Because there's so many things that I don't know that God has protected me from.
Yeah.
And of course, you have like 12 angels instead of one.
It takes at least that many. It takes a village.
Just the way you drive, the angels cannot fly that fast. But anyways, God still protects you. You know, so God has done all this in the past. But then God says, let me tell you what I will do in the future.
Mm-hmm.
And so verse 10, I will appoint a place for my people, Israel. You're going to be the king, but, you know, I'm going to do this. And look what it says on verse 11 and 12.
Even from the day that I commanded judges to be over my people Israel, and I will give you rest from all your enemies, the Lord also declares to you that the Lord will make a house for you.
I'll make a house for you. And I'm going to talk to you about your house and your descendant, but don't forget that I'm going to do that.
Yeah.
You don't have to be the one that is saying, okay, I got to do this. I got to do something because it didn't. No, I will do it, says God. Let's continue.
And when your days are complete and you lie down with your fathers, I will raise up your descendants after you who will come forth from you, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. And I will be a father to him, and he will be a son to me. And when he commits iniquity, I will correct him with the rod of men and the strokes of the sons of men. But my loving kindness, and that's the word hesed, or which is the fanatical love, my loving kindness shall not depart from him as I took it away from Saul, whom I removed from before you.
Yes. And so David, okay, this is where you came from. I was there with you.
Yeah.
I took your enemies from in front of you.
Mm-hmm.
Now you're king of Israel.
Mm-hmm.
Now let me tell you, while you're king, I'm going to do this. I'm going to give rest to my people through you. I'm going to do all these things. But let me tell you what I'm going to do when you're no longer here.
Yeah, your son's going to carry
it. Your son is going to carry this. he's going to be the one that builds my house. Because remember that David wanted to build a house for God?
But God said, no, it'll be your son.
Your descendant.
The other thing is that I know it says, if he commits iniquity, it doesn't say that. It says, when he commits iniquity.
Isn't that crazy?
I mean, I know he's going to mess up. He's as human as anybody else. He's going to commit iniquity. And when he does, I'll chastise him and I'll bring him back to where he needs to be.
But I will not remove from him my chesed, my grace.
My fanatical love, I will always pursue him. I will stalk him and I will bring him back.
I mean, what could be a greater promise than God saying, as long as you want to be my child.
Yeah. This is what I'm going to do for you.
This is what I'm going to do. And when you do iniquity, yes, I will try to bring you back.
Yeah.
But my love will not be removed.
Never removed.
And now help me, Mike. Help me give this image of God. Restore this healthy image of God in people's minds. That God loves us the way we love our children and a lot more.
Yeah.
When your children misbehave, do you love them any less?
Not at all. Not one iota less. I may be irritated with them, but I don't love them any less. Now, of course, my children are now adults, and so is my grandchildren, you know,
the same thing.
Yeah, same thing. And I don't love them any less when they have messed up than when they are just the sweet little angelic child sitting on my lap, you know? The love does not change.
But why do we view God that way? Like, if I misbehave, if I misplace something, if I, you know, took a detour, God now does not love me anymore.
We view God as being less loving than we are, which is just ludicrous. I mean, where did we come up with this picture? He is more loving than you've ever dared dream possible or I have ever dared dream possible. I'm not capable of that kind of love.
Exactly.
That's why hesed, that Hebrew word for love, is never used for man's love for a woman or a woman's for a man or a man's
for
his children. Because we are not capable of that kind of fanatical,
crazy
love.
Yes.
We can't do that. Only God has that capacity.
Mm.
And God loves me with that kind of fanatical love. So when I mess up, he knew I would. He says, I'm going to pursue you. I'll chastise you if necessary.
Yeah, I'll bring you back.
Because I'm getting you back here. I'll do whatever is necessary to bring you back to the fold because I will pursue you and never let you go. I love you like crazy. Now, that's the picture of God that we need to embrace. If you've grown up in a household where the father who was distant or was angry or was abusive or was conditional with his love, then you have a distorted picture of who God is.
How do you, if you have lived with a father that was abusive, how do you change in your mind that view of God?
There's not an easy way to do this. This is going to be a journey for you. But eventually you have to disassociate in your mind that early picture of an earthly father with your heavenly father. And you, part of what it is to find godly examples in your life who are around that begins to help change that picture. But eventually I think it's important to begin to use the sanctified imagination and imagine the best possible father that you can ever come up with. I mean, use that sanctified imagination and go wild with it. And then when you finally got that picture of the most loving, embracing father, you realize you've scratched the surface of how good he is. Multiply that by a billion and you've scratched the surface. He's much better than you've ever dared dream possible.
Yeah, because we can't even grasp how crazy his love is.
Who is it? Someone said the truth about God is that he is infinitely better than we've ever dared dream possible.
I like that.
That's the truth.
So on top of saying that he's going to have a son who will continue this, he makes a covenant that goes beyond his own son.
Mm-hmm.
And then he gets into the forever words.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to read verses 15 and 16 of the same chapter.
But my loving kindness shall not depart from him as I took it away from Saul, whom I removed from before you. Your house and your kingdom shall endure before me forever. Your throne shall be established forever.
Okay, here we go. Why these words forever? Obviously, Solomon wasn't going to be an eternal king.
No. But through David and Solomon's line will be established the king who will forever reign, and that is Jesus Christ.
Okay, so this is very important because when you get to the New Testament, aside from getting the whole genealogy of Jesus and David and all of that, and Matthew 1 and so forth, you will find that Jesus is called constantly the Son of David.
The Son of David.
So, when he says the kingdom of heaven has arrived or the kingdom of God has arrived, they were waiting for this prophecy to
absolutely
be fulfilled.
Absolutely.
So because, see, for us, kingdom of God has now become something different because we a lot of us are Christian and we're waiting for the kingdom of God, right? And we see that in the New Testament. But at that time, they were waiting for the descendant of David that had been promised in this chapter. Yeah.
And in a very real sense, the kingdom of heaven is here and it is in you.
Yeah.
Because Christ the King reigns in you. His kingdom is already established. We will see the visible representation
exactly.
of that with the second coming.
Exactly.
When all of evil is wiped away. But right now, he is king.
Yes.
He is Lord over all.
And this is one of the points that Matthew makes because Jesus already made his victory speech. Right now, we are... living between November 8th and January 20th. Here in the United States, November 8th is when a presidential candidate is declared victorious.
Mm-hmm.
January 20th is when they take over.
Right.
Right now, we are living in that in-between.
Right.
Jesus said already, all authority has been given to me on heaven and on earth.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And he's victorious. We
already
know
won.
How it ends.
He's won.
And very soon, he's going to take over the whole world.
That's right.
And
the inauguration address will be given.
That's right.
And the pledge of office given.
Exactly.
And he
will take over the forever kingdom.
But he's already won.
He's already won. That's the point. Now, look how David will answer, which is the main point of our program. When God has called you to something, don't ever think that you did this. Because we are unworthy of what he will do, and yet he still chooses us.
Verse 18, then David the king went in and sat before the Lord, and he said, who am I, O Lord God? And what is my house that you have brought me this far? And yet this was insignificant in your eyes, O Lord God, for you have spoken also of the house of your servant concerning the distant future. And this is the custom of man, O Lord God.
Yes, and what I'd like to read this last one as a question from the original. Is this the way of dealing? Is this your usual way of dealing with man, O Lord? How can this be?
Right.
I mean, I don't deserve this, says David, right?
Yeah, what more can David say to you? It says in verse 20. I don't understand. I don't get this.
Yes, it says,
it doesn't measure.
Who am I? Yeah. Instead of saying, yeah, Lord, I've been waiting for this for a while. I mean, you are so lucky to have me.
Yeah.
You know that joke that they say that one time there was a medal given to somebody for being so humble, and when he started wearing the medal, he lost it.
He lost the medal,
Well, this is the same type of thing. I mean, who am I, God, that you have called me to be a minister, a preaching of the gospel? I'm so unworthy of this.
Yeah.
And is this the usual way you deal with men, God? And of course, the next line she said, yes, it is.
Yes.
Because that's how I deal with people.
Yes.
Our creative director and producer is a very gifted man. His name is Chris James. And not only does he produce our programs and do many other things, but I don't know if you knew that he composes songs and he writes music and he sings. And some years ago, I asked him to sing this song called Unworthy for some talks that I was giving. I was so impressed with the lyrics of this song that I asked him if he would please sing it for this program. So here we go. Enjoy.
What can one give the giver of life? What can I offer the one who has all? Well, I feel so small 'cause you are so tall, and I'm overwhelmed by it all. Unworthy, I'll always be. Unworthy of the grace that you give. Yes, I'll always be the unworthy one. I try so hard, but I always fall short. I give you my all, but it's never enough. Well, I feel so small when you are so tall, and I'm overwhelmed by it all. Unworthy, unworthy, that's me. Unworthy, I'll always be. Unworthy of the grace that you give. Yes, I'll always be the unworthy one. Now, if grace that you give. Yes, I'll always be the unworthy one. Oh, I'll always be the unworthy one.
I hope you really enjoy that, because the words are so meaningful. That's why I love this song so much. You know, this is God's pattern. He chooses the least. And he reminds us, it's not because of who you are, it's because I loved you. For example, when the people of Israel came to possess the land, God kept saying in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 7, for example, verse 7 and 8, the Lord did not set his love on you or chose you because you were more in number than any of the people, for you were the fewest of the people. Verse 8, but because the Lord loved you and kept the oath which he swore to your fathers, the Lord brought you out by a mighty hand. And when you possess the land, says God, don't think it was because of your righteousness. I read now in chapter 9 of Deuteronomy, the verses, for example, 6 and 7. Know then that it's not because of your righteousness that the Lord your God is giving you this good land to possess, for you are a stubborn people. Verse 7. Remember, do not forget how you provoked the Lord your God to wrath in the wilderness. It's not because you are all there or because you have it all together, says God. As a matter of fact, you can read that whole chapter, verse 5, it is not for your righteousness or for the uprightness of your heart that you are going to possess the land. It's because I love you and I decided to give you this land. Same thing with David. It's not because of us, it's because of him. Well, here in the United States, as we said a moment ago, we have first the victory of the President of the United States, and then he takes over later. And it's almost 2 months. It's from November 8th to January 20th. So November 8th, you get the victory speech, right? And here we have Jesus' victory speech in Matthew chapter 28, verse 18. All authority has been given to me on heaven and on earth, says Jesus. So this is a done deal. Now, very soon is going to be like, you know, January 20th, where he will take over. In the meanwhile, you already know how the story ends. I don't know if you had the opportunity to become a citizen in a country. I did here in the United States, and I will be forever thankful for that experience. And they give us a passport that says, now you're a citizen of this country. Well, I want to introduce to you a different passport. Jesus says, look, I am the forever king, and you're invited to be the citizen of a forever kingdom. And don't ever think that it's going to be because of your righteousness that you will be in this kingdom. Oh, no, no. It's because of my great love for you and the grace I have for you, and I have chosen you to be there.